So, you want to study brain activity. In order to get accurate and precise data, we'll need a piece of technology like functional magnetic resonance imaging, or fMRI. fMRIs are extremely common in modern neuroscience studies, and with good reason. This tech can give us information about what kind of activity is happening in different parts of the brain in response to different tasks, or just at rest. If you've heard that a region of the brain lit up or was activated in response to being shown an image or hearing a sound, that news probably came from an fMRI study. Thousands and thousands of experiments have used fMRI, but the journalism surrounding the actual results of these studies can get, well, sensational. Media coverage about a specific study from 2008 claimed that scientists proved we can smell fear. Not only that, but fear is contagious. Let's dig into that, shall we? The actual study collected sweat samples from volunteers as they jumped out of an airplane. They also collected saliva before and after the jump to try and detect the stress hormone cortisol. Then, on a separate day, they had participants run on a treadmill and collected sweat and saliva again. The idea was that skydiving invoked a fear-based stress response, while the treadmill invoked a non-fear-based stress response, which acted as a control. There were multiple components to the study, but one involved placing separate participants in an fMRI, exposing them to a vaporized solution, which included either sweat collected from the skydiving conditions, sweat from exercise, or just air and scanning their brains. When the participants were exposed to the skydiver sweat, the researchers saw increased activation of their amygdalas, the so-called fear center of the brain. So if you were a journalist reporting on this study, you could reasonably make the connection that people could smell something in that sweat sample that indicated fear, right? That's a heck of a stretch. Regions associated with vision, goal-directed behavior, and motor control also lit up, not just the amygdala. fMRIs work by showing us where blood is flowing in the brain, but they can't tell you what someone is thinking. A more accurate headline would be that a study suggested that humans can signal emotional stress. Fear is contagious is a bit sensational. So today, we're going to learn the regions of the brain, what happens in each one, and how to correctly interpret a headline that makes a claim about your brain. As we learned in the last video, the brain is one of the key pieces in our central nervous system, along with the spinal cord. It has to interpret and process information it receives from the outside world, and then come up with responses for it. When we look at the brain from the side, we can see three big structures. First of which is the cerebrum, this enormous round part. We're gonna go into depth on the different pieces of the cerebrum in a moment, but for now, you can think of this as the big brain. And overall, that isn't a terrible way to remember this structure, because on the backside is a structure called the cerebellum, which literally translates to the little brain. This is where your body takes in certain sensory information and regulates movements like balance and coordination. Although more recent research shows that the cerebellum might process emotions and social behavior too. All in all, about half of your brain's neurons live in this part of the brain. Below the cerebrum and cerebellum is the brainstem. I personally used to think of the brainstem as just an interface for the spinal cord and brain, but it's so much more than that. Overall, it can regulate heart rate and breathing, as well as sleeping. It also connects most of the cranial nerves, which are involved in everything from facial sensation to swallowing. But most of the time when people are interested in which region of the brain does what, they're looking at the big brain, the cerebrum. All right, check this thing out. This is the standard view of your cerebrum. Right now we're looking at the outermost layer called the cerebral cortex. But if we were to slice it in half, we'd see deeper structures called subcortical structures, literally meaning underneath the cortex. Among all those subcortical structures are big players like the limbic system, which helps you express emotions, and the pituitary gland, which pumps out a bunch of different hormones. It also includes a structure that connects the two sides of the brain called the corpus callosum, a thick band of nerve fibers that lets the two sides of the brain communicate with each other. Each side of the cerebrum is called the hemisphere, the good old left brain and right brain. Now, you might have heard that the left brain is your analytical and logic-oriented side, while your right side is the creative side, and that you can be a right versus left brain person. Sorry, but that's not actually a thing. There's some evidence that each half deals with language differently, but past that, we're talking about minor differences at most. Importantly though, we can say definitively that the left half of the brain interprets signals from the right half of the body and vice versa. So the left hand is controlled by the right side of the brain, that kind of thing. Knowing that, we can finally look at what the different parts of the cerebral cortex do. First thing, look at all those different dips and ridges, also known as sulci and gyri, respectively. By having all those folds, you increase the surface area available and thus shove more brain into your brain. Those squiggly lines might seem like random bumps, but they help us divide the cerebral cortex further into different functional centers, or lobes. The biggest one is the frontal lobe, which is, as you guessed, in the front part of our brain. This is where we find a bunch of the structures that make us uniquely human. Most notably, our enormous prefrontal cortexes, which handle higher order functioning and cognition. Other animals have prefrontal cortexes, but we're the freaks with massive ones. The frontal lobe also houses Broca's area, one of our language processing centers, and another big deal center of the brain, the primary motor cortex. The primary motor cortex is a long region that extends over both halves of your brain, like over-ear headphones. And each moving body part is represented with a little strip of this cortex. Parts like your ankles or toes getting very little space, but pieces with complex motion, like your individual fingers, get a lot of space. Behind the frontal lobe is the parietal lobe, which processes information coming in from the body's senses. It has another cortex called the somatosensory cortex, which is split up to represent different body parts. So the area that represents the face is next to the area that represents the eyes and eyelids and so on. We see another cool phenomenon in this cortex. Our fingertips, tongue, lips, which all have lots of nerve endings, get a huge amount of space dedicated to processing their sensory input. Below the parietal lobe is the temporal lobe, which literally means near the temples. This is where we'll find the main areas of the brain that process hearing, called the auditory cortex. And that makes enough sense. The ears are like right there. The temporal lobe also has a special area called Wernicke's area that helps it interpret speech. Well, I should say Wernicke's area since it's German. Now, hearkening back to the days before fMRI studies, experiments made it seem like we had two speech centers, Broca's area for speech production and Wernicke's area for speech comprehension. In reality, language is handled in multiple networks around the brain. Behind the parietal lobe is our final lobe, the occipital lobe, the area where we process most of our vision. I know it seems weird that a lobe in the back of your head would interpret signals from the front of your head, but it'd be like that sometimes. Now, here's where I want to introduce some asterisks to the conversation. The primary visual cortex, the main spot where we process vision, is in the occipital lobe. But if we follow an image from the moment it hits our eyes until it's processed, we'll see that it's not that straightforward. After light passes through our eyes, it hits special photoreceptor cells in the back of our eyes called rod cells and cone cells. Each of those cells contains light-sensitive pigment that kicks off a chemical reaction that converts light into a nervous signal. Even before your eyes have decoded those photons, whether it's a notification on your phone or the words in your text message or your Timothée Chalamet wallpaper, that image is processed in part by the eye itself. From there, different aspects of vision get processed on different pathways. One of them carries information about shape, motion, and brightness, while another carries information about color and detail. Then some information goes towards the primary visual cortex, while some crosses the optic chiasma, a little bridge between the optic nerves that connects the left and right pathways. Then we have pathways in the brain that tie that visual information with the coinciding audio information, or smell, or touch. After all is said and done, after the visual cortex processes the image, it still relays that information elsewhere. Okay, I'm going into so much detail because I find it so fascinating that all this prep work has to be done to process one of the main ways we interpret the world, our sight. It's a great reminder that the brain is the most complicated piece of anatomy that exists. Yes, the skydivey sweat fMRI experiment I mentioned at the beginning showed increased activity in the amygdala. But be careful. When you're listening to the results of an fMRI study, whether it's on the news or if you go the extra mile and find the primary source, consider exactly what part of the brain is being reported on. Be sure to differentiate not just the lobe, but individual parts. Because as you can see, it's really hard to isolate one specific job to a whole lobe of the brain. Earlier, we mentioned Broca's area, an area named after French surgeon Pierre Broca after he noticed that two men lost their ability to speak after both of the patients suffered injuries to the sides of their heads. To him, that seemed like pretty good evidence that that part of the brain handled speech, and while it was more complicated than that, we call that area on the brain Broca's area in his honor. Thanks for watching this episode of Seeker Human. I'm Patrick Kelly.